Welcome. As you can see in the screen, Nike lawyers are more powerful than our lawyers. So for one night, we surrender our logo. It is my great pleasure to welcome and introduce Byron Merritt to lecture here tonight in SCI-Arc. It's always a particular moment of pride when we can welcome back one of our distinguished alums. Byron is very unique in that sense because his trajectory, it tours a little bit from the conventions of some of our other distinguished alums. And he's currently the Vice President of Retail Innovation at Nike, a company who's been there for 11 years. And we are happy that we are working with them in different projects. We just finalized one. But what I thought it was super important for us to have him to come and lecture at the school is because, of course, he's incredibly talented and gifted, but also because I think he can speak to a whole other aspect of what it means to think through the eyes of an architect in a whole other world of the culture of design. Not other world, but an expanded world of the culture of design. And I think this is a crucial time in that sense, because I think more and more we see that people who train as architects start to operate more and more often in many areas. This is, of course, something that has been happening in our profession for a long time. But right now we are in a particular interesting moment in which everybody's searching for new opportunities and new ideas and new forms of production. But the other thing which I thought it was super interesting to have Byron back at SCI-Arc is because I think there is a tradition in architecture, in particular in school, that always we are a little bit uncomfortable with when it comes to this creativity, architecture, design, commerce, branding. Some of these things are terms that we tend not to gravitate or to discuss more openly. And I think these are crucial in the times than we live for what is innovation and how things we move forward. So these different bridges need to be crossed in different ways, and I think Byron has done a remarkable job in doing that. So it is with great pleasure to welcome Byron back to SCI-Arc.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Hernan, thank you so much for having me here. And thank you for really spearheading the relationship between SCI-Arc and Nike. I think it's a really great thing. It's kind of incredibly humbling to be back here, to be honest with you. It's great to see a lot of old faces in the crowd. Some very good friends of mine found a way out here tonight, which is awesome. And a lot of new friends here tonight as well. So thank you. So yes, I've been at Nike about 11 years now, and I've had a number of roles at Nike, and they've all really evolved around the same thing. My title says VP of Retail Innovation, but my role at Nike has really evolved around the notion of kind of experience design and all the roles that I've had. And so I'm gonna talk a little bit about that, and actually less talk about it. I'm gonna show you a bunch of stuff. So. We'll see if we can get out of here in time because there's a ton of slides, but let's kick this off. Thank you. I love showing that because at the end of the day, whether you're really in the sport or kind of in the sport or not or whatever, it's incredibly difficult not to be moved by seeing some of that. And frankly, that's what gets myself and pretty much everyone up at Nike out of bed in the morning is those things that athletes are doing out there. So you know, at Nike, you know, innovation has always been a really important thing, and this is literally our mission here, is to bring inspiration and innovation to every athlete in the world. And when we talk about, you know, athlete, and we have an asterisk next to athlete, what we mean is if you have a body, you're an athlete, right? And so this is really about bringing inspiration and innovation to really the world, right? And particularly those that have made the decision to move and to pursue a world of sport. And, you know, Bill Bowerman, who's the founder of our company, who's here on the screen, he exemplified this notion of innovation. He was a coach, track coach, and he brought innovation to his athletes in every way, shape, and form, right? And strove to make the products better, faster, lighter, more durable, in order for them to reach their potential. And this is still at the heart of our company, right? And this is very true. It is our nature to innovate as a company. And you know, innovation has always been at the heart of products, the way that we design our products. And we believe we have some of the most innovative products in the world from a design and performance standpoint and an aesthetic standpoint. And this has set us apart from our competitors, and this has put us where we are now, right? And we continue to strive to remain in this place and to infuse innovation into our products, right? But I think it's we also realize is that you can always make a lighter product, a better cushioning system, a better method of making, and our competitors can do that as well, right? And so for us, as we strive for that innovation, we really look to athletes and all athletes as being fuel for that innovation, right? Particularly from a product standpoint. But not just from a product standpoint, in everything that we do, we listen to the voice of the athlete and we use that as our starting point and our muse and our motivation for doing the things that we do. And so, you know, one of the things that I want to talk to you guys about is this notion of experience innovation, because I think this is the thing that's the differentiator for us in the world today. Is yes, we continue to innovate on our products, but we innovate even more on the experiences that we create around those products. And so experience is a word that gets thrown out quite a bit within our world and within other worlds. And you know, for us, when we think about what one's experience with the brand is, it revolves around these four things. It's the products that we make. It's the services that we create around those products. It's how we speak about those products to a consumer, whether that's through broad and big marketing, or whether that's through what comes out of the mouth of a sales associate in store, or through some copy that's describing a particular product or service. And the places where we connect consumers with those products and services, and those can be physical places, and more increasingly, those digital places, right? So when we think about the experience one has with the brand, it's through these dimensions. And what's important about these dimensions is that, you know, as I was thinking about the way that we work, these dimensions are opportunity for creative exploitation, right? It's like when I think about crafting experiences, it's across all of these spectrums of the experience. And pulling on any and every lever that we can creatively to craft these experiences. And so, you know, the work that I'm going to show you tonight is really around that, right? Is how you look across that gamut of product, service, environment, and communication, and pull on whatever levers one needs to pull on creatively to craft the right experiences for consumers around our products and services. And, you know, if I were to sum it up in a really simple way, it's about this aspect of really considering the looks-like aspect of it, and we're really good at this, right? The looks-like aspect of our products and our services and our experiences, we make beautiful stuff, right? But more importantly, what's the acts-like aspect of it? What's that experience that someone's gonna have? What's the journey that we're gonna take someone on when they engage with our brand, right? And it's these two things that, at the end of the day, are about experience design, right? Crafting it to its utmost, but really thinking through the journey and steps that we want to take someone through, right? So the first project that I'm going to talk about is, this is an old project, but it's an interesting project because it's exactly that, right? We had, so the Nike Plus Fuel Band. So the Nike Plus Fuel Band was an activity tracking device. And I think Hernan and I were talking about it this morning. It's kind of funny to think back that at that time, those really weren't out there in the world. I think there were two others in the marketplace at the time. And this was definitely a new to the world product, and a definitely new to Nike product, right? This notion of tracking all day activity with a digitally enabled device. And so as we were thinking about that product and experience around the product, the campaigns that we launched around bringing that product to life, the experiences at retail in order to explain that proposition and have a consumer understand that product and buy into it, and the activation and events that we created around it to elevate that product, it was quintessentially this a project of experience design. And so, as we created this product and we were trying to get consumers to understand this notion of fuel and counting their all-day activity, we needed a way of articulating the aspect of movement counts. And so, this is how we went out into the world to show that. See, I keep forgetting where I have to click for the movie or not.
Can you count, suckers?
Come on. Woo! Make it on down. I see you, baby. Shake it and bang. Shake it and bang. Shake it and bang.
So I usually start this before I play this. I do a little quiz, right? And it's usually the question is like, can anyone name the first character that shows up in that in the video? And it's a good one because it's an age qualifier because it's definitely a generational thing. So can anyone name who that first guy was who's like, can you count, sucker? And what movie? Yes. And what was his name? All right, that's good enough. It was Cyrus from the Warriors. That was amazing. Who knew that? Okay. Yeah. No, it was probably some, yeah, okay. But yeah, an interesting story about that. When that piece was made, it was, the team was putting that together. And as you can imagine, there's a bunch of clearance rights that needed to happen in order to make that piece, right? Because it was it came from a lot of different sources, and so we have a business affairs team that does that work, right? And so they were going out in the world and trying to find all the people that were appearing in these clips in order to make sure that they were taken care of, and so the guy who played Cyrus from the Warriors, which was I think that movie was made in like 1972 or 5 or something like that. No one could find him, right? No one could find this guy. And they ended up finding him because he had sued a video game company that had made a Warriors game, and it had been compensated, and he was in some nursing home somewhere, and he got a little surprise payday, which is nice. So getting consumers to understand this notion of making it count, part of the campaign was around getting consumers to share that, to share their movement, right? And so we had, we inspired, engaged others through Instagram and Twitter to share how they were making it count. And it was a really successful part of the campaign that got like deep participation amongst consumers and really started to solidify this notion of movement and activity and what counts and what didn't count, right? And so, you know, as I mentioned at the beginning of this, we're a footwear and apparel company, right? And we know how to promote that. We know how to make campaigns about it, and we know how to sell it. And you know, this is a wholly new product to us, and to a lot of people, a wholly new product to the world. And so, we really had to understand and scrutinize that journey that we wanted to take a consumer through in order for them to understand and buy into this proposition. And so, we had a really simple journey, and that journey was we're going to help consumers learn about the product, we're going to allow them to try it, we're going to help them buy it, we want them to have it set up, and we want them to go and start moving, right? And this seems like super simplistic, but for something that's new to the company and trying to galvanize an entire company around being able to bring this to life in a way consistently across the globe, this journey was really helpful, right? And it was also really helpful for the creative team in thinking about what are the moments that we need to craft, right, in terms of bringing this to life. So what was kind of remarkable about that at the time is there was one team that crafted all of that, and that's the physical space, that are the full-scale interactive experiences that happen in those spaces, the stations in which a sales associate would take someone through the proposition of fuel ban, the digital interface and how one touches and moves through that digital interface in order to explain the proposition in a really simple way. And then the technology to allow one to literally hook up the band and get them set up so that they were ready to go, and ways for them to seamlessly purchase this, right? So there were multiple levels of kind of creative thought that went into it. And it's funny to look on this because I look at it and almost can't even believe that, you know, it was a team of like 10 of us basically that crafted all this. And this was in our flagship store in Nike Town, New York, as the premier destination for bringing that to life. And up until this point, we'd never done anything that immersive in terms of digital and physical technology, interactivity, and interface design in order to bring this to life. So, you know, to further kind of explode this notion of fuel and movement and making it count, we looked for an opportunity to bring this to life in a venue and in a time that felt like right for this type of product. And South by Southwest, the interactive music and film festival in Austin, Texas, felt like a good place, right? And it's funny, like normally Nike would never show up at South by Southwest up at this time, you know? A lot of us would go to see what was going on in the world, but having a brand presence there didn't make a lot of sense. But for us, this notion of technology, music, sport, and culture coming together made sense. And so so we went down to South by Southwest, and we had a several-day, like, huge activation around Fuel Band. And I still go to South by Southwest. I won't be going this year. It's actually in, like, a week or two or something like that. But I've been a number of times since. And to this day, people still talk about that Nike activation that that happened at that time. And so what the team did is we built an outdoor experience that allowed people to kind of move and use the Fuel Band in a really fun and interactive way. We had a space that where it was only one of two places in the world that you could buy the product at the time because we had just released the product. And so we had a pop-up space within Austin, Texas to where you could get the band. That space also turned into a venue at night where we had these concerts, and the space itself acted almost like a large Fuel Band in terms of the movement in the space was reflective within the environment, which you'll see. And then we had some very broad activations in the city where we had an interactive wall that was a block long that sat between this outdoor sport court and this venue. And so, you know, if any of you have ever been to South by Southwest, there's the seminars and the talks that happen during the day. But the real reason for going to South by Southwest is the deep networking that happens there. And a lot of that happens in the parties that happen in the evenings. And those parties are typically centered around music, right? And so currency at South by Southwest is access, the ability to get into these venues and get into these performances, because performers from all over the world come. And so we had this this notion of I'm with the band, right? Pun intended. Having the Fuel Band gave you access to a lot of things that we were doing within this time frame. And so so we had a lot of things around earning fuel and earning enough fuel, gave you access to some things that we were doing at the time. So we had this place of activity. We built out this sport court that was out in the middle of Austin, Texas, and we had a multitude of things. You could play basketball there. We had dodgeball games going on. We had skateboarding going on and all that. But again, it was around emphasizing this notion of activity and movement. The pop-up space, again, was almost like a physical Fuel Band. So during the day, it was basically a store where you could buy the Fuel Band and get it, and again, learn, try, buy, get it set up and go in the same way that we did for Nike New York. And again, this was the only place in the world outside of Nike Town New York where you can get this product, and it was a very desired product at the time. Then outside, we had a block-long interactive wall that showed the activity of South by Southwest that was going on at that time. So the fuel stream was happening at that time of people posting to Twitter and Instagram and reflecting their activity. We also made that wall interactive so that as people walked by, it literally showed the movement of the city. That was, like, ridiculous that we did this, put this giant wall in the city. It was super fun. So again, we had activities planned all day on the sport court. At night in the venue, we had kind of major music performers come into the space, and literally the space pulsed with the amount of movement within the environment in the same way that the Fuel Band would. You know, we had the Fuel Band, green meant go, red meant that you weren't moving enough, and so people were definitely moving there that night. And then it culminated with on one of the final nights with a huge concert within the venue, the activity happening within the space being represented on the block-long LED screen out on the street, and Frost Tower, which is the tallest building in downtown Austin, was lit up red to green. So it actually lit up with the energy and activity of the space being reflected on the tallest building in the city. And all of it kind of looked a little bit like this. So again, I think that project and campaign really exemplified that notion of looks like and acts like, right? So without either of those two, we wouldn't have had what we had, right? So yes, there were all the creative things that happened in terms of bringing to life those venues, bringing to life the digital experiences and all that, but all of that was highly crafted and choreographed over the course of several days within South by Southwest. And that's not something to overlook, right? Because there's a creative mindset to just doing that, to just crafting and scripting what that journey is, right? And how all of those elements come together to craft that experience for those that were engaging within that. So I'm gonna shift gears a little bit. This one's a pretty straightforward project, to be honest with you. It's really about taking an identity of a product and bringing it to life in a physical way, in a pretty simple way. And so there's a line of product that's called a tech pack that is a performance fleece that we have. And we were bringing this to life for the first time a few years ago and wanted to bring this to life physically within New York. So I'll run a little pre-video and then I'll show you what the team did. So the brand design team had created a pretty distinct kind of identity around this product line, you know, as you see here, and it was really around emphasizing this notion of warmth without weight. And so the team built a space in New York as a way to showcase that product, but then also provide a seating opportunity for friends of the brand. So it's a space where we could bring in athletes and entertainers that are close to the brand and give them the product early before it hit the market. And so it's a really simple kind of beautiful design that the team put together of these display cases where the product hung almost weightlessly within the space and kind of the red glow representing the warmth that the product provides. And this space was in There's a space in New York, Moynihan Station, which is the old post office building in New York, and it's a remarkable space. There's another project that I'm going to show here as well that we did in Moynihan Station as well. To give you a sense of scale of the space, 60% of all U.S. mail, not New York mail, all U.S. mail used to pass through that building, which is incredible. And so they're actually converting that space into being the Amtrak station, because it's right across the street from Madison Square Garden. So again, a little seating space at the back of the space where we can bring kind of friends of the brand and immerse them in this product and have deep kind of technical conversations around the product and then give it to them. So this next project, again, this is in Moynihan Station, is a project again several years ago. It's we call it the JDI NYC experience. JDI is shorthand in our world for just do it. And so, you know, it's funny at Nike, we've got all these acronyms for everything. And I was working with Nike as a consultant a couple of years before I actually joined Nike. And so, you know, so I had kind of a leg up on someone that was new to the company, but literally the first several months at Nike, I'd sit in meetings and have no idea what people were talking about because of the acronyms that we use in the brand. But anyways, so this JDI experience in New York was around highlighting some key products of the season, and particularly products that were around the winter, right? And so. So we did this in Moynihan Station, the old post office, and this manifesto kind of took from literally what's on the front of the building. So there's the saying, neither snow nor rain nor heat or whatever it says for the post office. The team kind of took that and adapted it to being able to highlight these products. And so what was interesting about this project is that we had five key products that we needed to bring to life. And we needed to have an enormous amount of people go through this experience to kind of understand these products. And so we built an experience that was literally like a machine, a space that was like a machine in terms of running people through and getting them up to speed and understanding these products. Some of the folks that came through here were our retailers, so our own sales associates, but also sales associates for partners, partner retailers. And it was really about getting them to understand these products before the holiday season. And then we took consumers through this as well, again, to get them ready, and they had the ability to kind of buy this product early before others. But it was an interesting, again, it's another one of these examples of like pulling on all levers to kind of craft this experience, from physical space to crafting films to sound design to again scripting that entire journey and having people involved that will convey some of this stuff and having them in the right place at the right time and all that. So guess what? There's another video, and then I'm gonna go through some slides.
It says it right on this very building. Neither snow nor rain nor heat nor gloom of night strays these couriers from the swift completion of their appointed rounds.
Welcome, guys, to the House of Innovation.
It's like a revolutionary second skin for your foot.
We have a brushed inner surface that's really going to help produce some heat and insulate you during those colder months.
It's lightweight, It's really thin, but it's still gonna provide that warmth that you're keen to. It's gonna give you the right amount of warmth, but still give you that ventilation that you desire.
It actually allows us to be seen at any moment on your jacket. Doesn't matter where light is reflecting off of it.
I'm excited to try this vest out, the Aeroloft.
So the beauty of that space in Moynihan is that at the time it was an incredibly kind of raw space. And I think the team took the approach of like, instead of, because I think a normal approach would be like, how can we skin this and hide all the imperfections and create like this pristine box in order to bring these products to life? But instead we like embraced the kind of roughness and rawness of that building and kind of did just enough, right? Just brought in just enough in order to highlight the things that we wanted to highlight and kind of script and craft that journey and move visitors through that space in a way that that felt right. So this image here, this isn't a loading dock, you know? We entered through the loading dock and created a kind of a tunnel-like experience that brought you into the space. And what I loved about the Moynihan space is that it's cavernous, right? But you actually have the ability to like completely black it out, right? And so one of the things that I pushed the team on was to, let's start from the space being pitch black and work up as a way to kind of guide one through this experience. And that worked in our favor in a lot of ways, right? And I'll talk a little bit through that in the sense that we had these five kind of product vignettes, right? And it was really simple. It was a really simple kind of framework on the sides. Everything was crazy functional, but unbelievably refined. Does that work? Yeah. So you had these were 12 foot by 12 foot rear projection screens, right? And we didn't try and hide any of that stuff. The projectors were just laying out in the space. We had the cabling just like pristinely kind of pulled through the space. We had the lighting done in a way that obviously didn't emphasize those aspects, but emphasized the things that we wanted, which was the product. So there were five kind of product vignettes. And when one walked into the space was essentially pitch black, except the product being lit within the center. And so, as I said, the space acting like a machine, it literally acted like a machine in the sense that we ran about 30 or 40 people through at a time. We'd have an associate stand here who's gonna kind of explain the product proposition, but they would stand there, the screens on the side would come to life and play kind of a reel, which I'll show you, right? That kind of loosely explains the proposition. The associate would talk in depth about the product for about 2 or 3 minutes. And then it'd be like 3 or 4 minutes for the guests to kind of interact with the product and ask questions. Then that space would go dark. The next space would subtly light up. The screens would come to life. And it just drew everyone through that space. And again, there's the creative stuff of like, okay, how do we build this and design this stuff? And how do we bring these product propositions to life and all that? But for me, the thing that's super enjoyable is the creative aspect of like, how do we make this thing work, right? Again, that looks like and acts like. How do we make this act in a way that is gonna achieve what we're trying to do? So that's it all fairly lit up, but that's how consumers came into the space. And then the first vignette was on this footwear proposition of Free Flyknit. And one of the things that was really important about all of these vignettes, and we talk about this a lot at Nike, is the notion of innovation storytelling, right? There's a lot of innovation within our products. How do you convey that in a way that consumers truly understand what the performance benefits are and the innovation benefits are of our products in the simplest way, right? And not try and tell every single story, but tell the story that's gonna get someone to understand it immediately, right? And so for this particular product, it was about what we talked about as a revolutionary second skin fit. So this is a Flyknit product that was a woven product at the time, and it fit like a second skin. And this was on a free platform, so it was very flexible, right, and moved with your foot. And so, again, that design conveyed that in a very simple way of articulated feet going to the most articulated, and then being wrapped continuously up to the point of creating a whole shoe, right? And so then, again, we had these vignettes on these videos on the side that came to life that opened up each space. And that was a creative endeavor in itself of, like, how do you bring in a notion of free Flyknit, second skin fit, put this in the context of other products, emphasize the notion of lightweight. So again, what's interesting about that, it wasn't like, oh, hey, let's go get the video guys to make a video for us. It was the same team, the same people that were thinking about, like, all right, what's the best way to kind of convey this physically? What's the best way to build the structure? What's the best way to kind of light and make this work? It's the same creatives that sat in the shoot and made these videos come to life. So the next vignette was around a product called Hyperwarm, and it's a base layer product, right? And again, the notion is around protected against the cold, right? And again, really simple, straightforward way of conveying that notion in a really beautiful way. It's like you see it and you get it. That's what the product proposition is about. I get what the core innovation is of that product, right? And then bringing that to life in a video that kind of reflects it all. So this next vignette was around this Dri-fit wool, and so it was around warmth from nature, and it had an incredible ability to kind of wick moisture. And so, again, same creatives thinking about the lighting design and the physical setup and the films and all that. We had these LED bulbs that kind of went backwards and kind of represent this notion of moisture wicking. It was really beautiful. And I won't play this whole video because we'll be here forever because I got a couple more to go. But But I will say what was interesting, I remember we were working with a consultant who was helping physically set up the lighting at the time, and we were testing this, and so the teams were out there building all the physical stuff, and he was there trying to tune the lighting, and we turned on the video, and he was like, what is this? This all works together. And we were like, yeah, we thought about it that way. So this next one is a product called Aeroloft, and this is a beautiful product where it's a down vest, and that down vest is perforated, so it's there's a lot of thermal regulation that happens in it. It's incredibly lightweight and really, really beautiful, and again, trying to convey this notion of lightweight warmth. Again, super elegant, really simple way of conveying that by hanging this product within a cloud of feathers. Again, just being able to convey that proposition in a very simple way. And then emphasizing the lightweightness of the perforations through light coming through there. And again, I won't play that. It's pretty similar to the one we've seen before. And then this last one is this this flash jacket. This is a running jacket that has micro beads in it. And the entire jacket is reflective. It's really beautiful, really beautiful product. And so this was about being seen. Again, just a really simple, beautiful vignette where these lights would flash in a way that from the viewer's perspective, you actually saw the reflectivity in the jacket. And this one had, this one's actually my favorite from a sound design standpoint, so I'll actually play it. So as one came out of that last vignette, there was a reveal at the end, right, where the lights would come up at the end, and it was a highly curated kind of mannequin display of all the products that they just experienced, and curated in a way in which, you know, in a way that someone would actually wear it, and again, like a really beautiful surprise at the end. In addition to that, we built a digital experience that allowed. Consumers that were going through to actually reserve the product and buy it. And so again, it was kind of a 360 thinking about the entire journey. And so the last part of the experience, and I'll just touch on this one because it's interesting at the time. We used to have a logo that would represent Nike in New York. New York has always been a very important city to us. And so the team was trying to work on what would that be today, right? And at this time, we were kind of emphasizing that notion of movement and activity and all that. And someone had the idea of, why don't we let the movement of the city start to alter our logo and make the logo for us? And so it's a really beautiful kind of simple solution to end up making that mark. And that showed up, we ended up using that quite a bit within New York City, and I think even today we still use it within the city. And in the space at the time, we had an area where all the consumers walked through that over time, that mark would start to reveal itself. So this is the project. Actually, Hernan and I were talking today, and he asked, like, one of my favorite projects at Nike, and this is one of them. And this is a project called Swoosh ID, and it was around customization, around the ability to customize product and do it within minutes. You know, currently, our Nike ID experience is like you customize a product online, and it's a fairly immersive experience of like creating your product, and then that gets shipped to you in like 3 to 4 weeks. And so there was a technology that the product innovation teams were working on that allowed us to customize product in a very simple way and in an incredibly fast way. So instead of waiting weeks for your product, that we could have this done in 10 minutes, right? And so the team was working on improving this printing technology, and they were making all these improvements on it, and they were going to these meetings and like, look, we can print better, it's more durable, blah, blah, blah. And so, leadership asked my team at the time, hey, can you work with that team and craft an experience that leverages this capability? So we said, sure. And so the proposition was this. We had, there was a style of shoe, and that style of shoe had a white swoosh. And the shoe itself looked great, you know, in that base color and the white swoosh. You could just buy it that way if you wanted to. But that swoosh was actually a canvas for the printer so that you could simply change the color pretty quickly. And so, you know, typically when we would do customization experiences at retail, it would be an experience that we would take you to, right? And so instead of doing that, we decided, like, how do we just embed this experience within the journey that the consumer is already on, right? And so, you know, I think we've all had this experience where you show up at retail, you're looking for a pair of shoes, and oftentimes you've got an idea of what you want. You're like, you know what, I want an all black shoe, right? And so currently you walk up to the footwear wall and you look up there and you're like, that one's got black in it, that one's kind of black, that one's all black but it doesn't have the style that I want. And so the consumer has to compromise, right? So they buy one of those or they simply walk out of the door because they're not satisfied. And so what this technology allowed was for a consumer to make a small tweak to that product to get exactly what they wanted. And it was in a particular style. And so, again, instead of like, hey, let me take you over to the kiosk where you can do this, we decided to embed it in the footwear wall because that's where the consumer is on their journey, right? And not just embed it in the footwear wall, let's embed it in a way that's pretty seamless. And so, there's a monitor in the wall, right? And the team rendered the product in a way that literally reflected the shadows of the physical product and all that. So it was seamlessly embedded in the wall. And once the consumer's engaged with that screen, it turned into a really, really simple interface, right? And so we needed a way for a consumer to make a very quick choice, right? So there were 12 base colors of the shoe, and there were 25 swooshes that you could choose from. So it was a simple interaction of I scroll left and right to get to that base color, I scroll up and down to get to the swoosh, and I'm done. That experience was about 90 seconds for most consumers, where a typical Nike ID experience was about 30 or 40 minutes, right? And we had Nike ID experiences within retail where consumers would engage for, you know, 30 or 40 minutes and oftentimes not buy anything, right? And so we wanted to make something like super simple and super straightforward to allow the consumer to get what they want in the most seamless way, right? And so, you know, as we started to think about that journey, we said, well, you know, if a consumer makes an interaction on the wall, then how does an associate know that you had that interaction, right? And so we built in the capability of the consumer being able to put their name in there, and then that notified a mobile device that was on an associate. And then that mobile device had the ability to make some small tweaks as the consumer changed their mind, right? So I was thinking through that. And it's like, well, okay, so we've got this digital printer in the back of house of the store. How does the digital printer in the back of the house know that someone had this interaction on the wall? And so we had to build that, right? So we built the iPad interface that showed the selections that consumers were making that alerted the associate that was back there working on the product to be able to make what one wanted, right? And to have the right tools there. And it's like, okay, cool. And so, hey, when we deliver this product to the consumer, how do we differentiate this and make it feel just a little bit more special than the product that they would just buy normally? And so, you know, that's the printed swoosh on the product. And then just really simple, a super simple kind of tag that went on the edge of the the box that represented the base color that they chose, and then handwritten their name on it. That just made it more theirs, right? So when a consumer comes to the wall, it's like, well, how do they know? How do they know that they should engage with that screen? You know, and so the team created an animation with the screen where all of a sudden the screen would start to come to life subtly, right? And it would start to change, and it would start to take you into the proposition that, like, oh, I can do something with these shoes. And so it would go through this this animation loop as a way to kind of attract and engage the consumer on the idea of being able to make some changes to the shoes and make it their own. So again, this would happen periodically in the wall to have the consumer understand that they can engage. So there was the call to action in the bottom of the screen. The consumer would tap into the screen, and it turned instantly into that very simple interface that I talked about, right? And again, that interface was like crazy simple. So scroll left and right, pick the base color that you want. And you scroll up and down for the swoosh. And here's the thing, like, this type of work takes like unbelievable discipline, right? Because there's a gazillion things we could have done, right? But we kept shoving everything through the lens of speed. How can I get this as quickly as possible and as seamlessly as possible? So you had the ability to change your laces as well. So again, really simple interface where you'd scrub your finger along the top of the screen to pick your laces. And then we had the ability to tap in and add some subtle graphics to the swoosh as well. And again, all this seems really simple, but there were like 50-some thousand combinations that someone could choose from. So although the interaction was crazy simple, there was still quite a bit of choice for consumers at that time. So I think this next slide's a video. I'm just gonna, I don't know where I gotta hit it before it goes, but there we go. So you notice in the video, there's a part where it says in-store printer, and then the video jumps. I can't show you that, so I had to cut it out. But here's the thing, right? As like simple as that experience was for consumers, there's unbelievable complexity behind it, right? And I like to show this because this is it. This is the complexity behind it. And I like to show this for two reasons, because this was a systems engineer didn't sit down and map this out. This was a designer on my team that sat down and like thought through this entire journey so that we knew what we were doing and we knew what we had to craft and when we needed to craft it and how we needed it to come together, right? This is like deep thinking. And again, this is a designer on my team that took the time to sit down to think this through, right? And I think that's the power of kind of creative thought. When we think about, again, the looks like aspect, we can do that all day, right? And we're good at that. The acts like aspect of the discipline of really scrutinizing and understanding that journey is what's required of these types of experiences. I'm gonna go really fast to this because I still got a lot of slides. This is for Super Bowl 48 in New York City, and this was an immersive experience around bringing to life some key products during the Super Bowl, particularly under this notion of unleashing speed, right? This was also in Moynihan. I had a love affair with Moynihan Station in New York. It's such a great space, great canvas for doing some amazing stuff. So we had what we called the House of Innovation. I'm gonna like totally fly through this. Video, which, I'll let the video go. So again, I'm gonna go through this pretty quickly, but we had this space in Moynihan Station, and as you saw in the video, we had a lot of consumers come through it, and particularly like schools. We had a lot of local schools come through, and not just kind of walk through the space, but be able to participate and be athletes for the afternoon. And so there were a number of kind of beautiful vignettes that we brought to life, and I'm gonna skip these videos. And the first one was around Flyknit. We had three different products that were made out of Flyknit: a running shoe, a basketball shoe, and a training shoe. And we wanted to unify these in a vignette that brought to life this notion of the method of make, being Flyknit, but also this notion of speed in terms of unleashed speed. And so the team took kind of inspiration from kind of the shock cones of supersonic aircraft and used that as kind of a muse and metaphor for creating this pretty amazing installation, right? And this was all woven out of cable. It's pretty phenomenal to see that actually come to life in the space and the craftspeople that we worked with to bring that to life. There are these beautiful kind of halo lighting devices that were created that highlighted the product in a really simple and beautiful way. But the level of detail and just in the crafting of this vignette is like ridiculous. I remember having conversations about like, nope, we want that woven through that piece of aluminum, not just wrapped around it. And our partner's like, okay. So again, just a really kind of beautiful installation. This one I'm gonna go through pretty quickly. This was just a way of showing kind of the sideline gear for the Super Bowl that year. Again, light and cables, really simple way of bringing that to life. This one here is actually one of my favorites. So this was a digital wall that was around the genealogy of training footwear, right? So kind of the history of training footwear done in a really beautiful and really simple way where these LED light bulbs were interactive in a way that kind of, you know, explained what the proposition was around this genealogy. It would run through this interstitial animation. It would highlight a particular product along that timeline. It would tell you the name and the year of that product. And again, it's just a really beautiful physical and digital execution that the team put together. So again, these animations are great. Highlights that particular product and then gives you the name and the year that it was created. So again, just super beautiful kind of lightweight, basically a virtual footwear wall. And it's really fun to play with these technologies. This last vignette was around the uniforms for not only for the Super Bowl, but for local high school teams that were coming in there as well. So you can imagine as a local high school athlete to come in and see your school uniform in the same context as the Super Bowl teams. It was amazing for these kids. So just a really simple way of kind of bringing that to life with kind of an endless mirror effect that doesn't really come across in the images to show kind of a field where there was none. So this part right here is actually my favorite part. So one of the key products was the Vapor Talon cleat for the Super Bowl. And what we wanted to create was the 40-yard dash, which for the NFL Combine is a significant measure of one's athleticism. And so we didn't want to fake it. Like, that's NFL quality turf that we had laid within that space, right? But we didn't want to just like have the consumer have the ability to wear the cleats and run the 40-yard dash. We wanted to capture it in a way that allowed them to share it, right? And have some competition in the space. So there was a 40-yard track of turf. There was a 50-yard LED screen that highlighted the fastest runner of the day. So you always ran against the fastest runner of the day. So that ghost is the fastest runner of the day. But we wanted also consumers to have a takeaway, right? Not just do it and go home and be like, man, that was cool. But we wanted to capture it, right? And so we had this high-speed camera on a rail that would track them as they ran. It was crazy complex. It was super fun to do, but it's one of those things where the technical teams that we're working with were like, you want to do what? You know, because you know, in the movie industry, they do this a lot, right? But what they were telling me is like, well, we don't do this like hundreds of times a day. You know, it's like we can do it a couple of times, but so we had them do it hundreds of times a day. And what that did was this. We had it track the consumer from the standpoint of them taking off to them crossing the finish line. And then we had that turned into a 15-second Instagram video. And this was at the time when video was relatively new on Instagram, so we were leveraging that platform. And it gave the consumer that takeaway that they could post, and they got that within minutes of the experience. So so the ability to capture and then produce those videos and then push it out to the consumer was an unbelievable undertaking. Well, this is an example of one of the videos that you would get. And they were all pretty much situated the same way. So we had a front-facing camera that would capture you on launch. Then it would switch to the high-speed camera on the side that tracked your feet, panned out, captured your full body in motion, and then caught you at the finish line and showed your time. So that was pushed out to the consumer within minutes, and they had the ability to kind of post that on Instagram. Ridiculously complex to make that happen. Behind the wall, it literally looked like mission control with folks back there kind of putting these videos together as real time as possible. And then we pushed that content out to the street. So around the corner is this digital billboard that Nike's had for a while, where we were heroing the athletes, the kid athletes inside of the space on the street. So making them heroes within their own city, which was pretty awesome. And again, everyone had the ability to do this. So, you know, at the end of the day, it's really about these kids, right? These kids had a phenomenal experience there, and they were, you know, they were treated like athletes, right? And, you know, were experts talked to them about the products. They were able to participate. They had locker room experiences where they were able to try the product before anyone else. Some of their heroes showed up, like Bo Jackson was there. And it was a bit of a competition, and they were celebrated as winners. And at the end of the day, it's like really making these kids' day. It was a pretty phenomenal experience. So this is the last one. You guys with me? So this is fairly recent. So this is a customization experience that we did in New York, Nike by You, and we call it the Maker Experience, right? We've done a number of customization experiences at Nike in the past, and this one's this one's kind of special and different for a couple of reasons. So we built a space within New York City that allowed a consumer an immersive experience around customization. It was very real time. All of it was real time. So there was an interactive wall here that allowed you to see the choices that you were making. Most importantly, there was this device here. This is a live design device. And this was a device that we worked on with the Wieden & Kennedy Lodge team. So Wieden & Kennedy has been our agency, and they have a small subset within the agency that is focused on technology and emerging technologies. And they worked on a live projection mapping technology with us for this experience that allows the consumer to stand within this arena, see real-time changes on their feet, literally on their feet. You can move around and all that, and then that be reflected on the wall and allow you to kind of create your story through that experience. So you stand in the center, it lights up. You see real time the graphics changing. The wall illuminates as well, again showing that. So that's essentially how the experience is coming to life. There's someone there who's walking you through. It's voice activated. You say, hey, I want this larger, I want this smaller, I want this gray, red, I want it green. We had four base graphics to choose from. We had this grand type expression. This is what we called Brand Slam. So these were a number of different old logos through Nike's history that you could remix. There was a camo variation, and then there was a variation that was herringbone, which is part of our heritage. You see that on some of our classic footwear. So you had the ability to input text, right? Your name, your number, you know, or whatever, and it influenced the way that that the graphics would come to life. So all of these were remixable in a way that that you would get a very unique unique design. The shoe was a version of the Presto, so the version that we call Presto X. And I'll tell you later why we created a different version of the shoe, but one reason is that it was one that the materials used in the shoe allowed it to take projection in a really great way. So again, you stood in the arena and you had the ability to look down at your feet and see the graphics changing. There was mirrors on the side that allowed you to see that as well. So again, it all changed real time. I mean, these are obviously static images, but it all changed real time as you were making choices. So not only that, the overall environment would change with you as well. So it was a super immersive experience around kind of customizing and personalizing your footwear. But here's the thing. This is what differentiated this experience from other customization experiences. You could get that product in under an hour, right? And so we had what we called a maker cell within that space where your shoes were made for you in under an hour, which is pretty remarkable for you to get something that personal and that customized and have it in an hour. There will be no pictures of what's inside there. And so that product would show up in under an hour exactly as you kind of crafted them within that experience. So it's a really beautiful, beautiful experience. And for us, that's a way of us kind of like testing some ideas, right? Testing some ideas around rapid product creation, testing some ideas around simple but immersive personalization and customization. Teams created a bag that, again, would also reflect the graphic pattern that you chose, so you walk out with a pretty custom thing. And
we are dreamers and makers, constantly pushing the boundaries of what's possible to bring tomorrow to today. Today, you are the maker. Today, your story becomes your shoe. Faster than you can imagine. Welcome to the Nike Maker Experience.
So that's it, but I'm going to leave you with one last thing, and it's this.
Taken by Iguodala. Iguodala to Curry, back to Iguodala, up for the layup. Oh, blocked by James!
The biggest goal in the history of the Portugal national team.
No stopping Serena, 23rd major title. Yeah, Cinemax Federer.
It's not the absolute numbers that matter. It's picking the goal that you think is impossible.
How in the world?
Oh, my goodness.
And he is insane.
Wake up in the morning, all systems on go. Cause I got goals and I won't take no for an answer. Got the grace of a dancer, the heart of a panther. I don't understand you. It puts in your vocab. I cannot quote that. I want this so bad. I cannot go back. I cannot back down. I will not give up. You versus me, huh? I say good luck. You don't want this problem. Cause I don't do it unless I go full throttle. And I might throw it on Instagram. Just to show you what the difference is. For instance, I'm up with the roosters. I'll run the runners. I'll shoot the shooters. Look in the mirror. Hey, girl, let's do this. My only competition is myself. That's why I keep some trophies on the shelf. Never lazy cause it's bad for my health. Da-da-ding, da-da-ding. Bada boom, bada bang. Now let's go.
got you right here.
Guess who stepped in the ring? Don't think I lost it, I'm just getting started. It's time to sweat. Another rep, another set. Oh yeah, another lap, another mile. About to turn up the dial.
Thanks, guys.